A very good morning to all of you guys. So she is another daughter of India who has brought honor for our country. She is Avni Lekhre, who has become the first Indian woman to win a gold medal in Paralympics. So she is a shooter and she has won the gold medal in 10 meter air rifle shooting in the ongoing Paralympics that are going on in Tokyo. So as you would know that after every Summer Olympics, there are Paralympics that are organized for the persons with disability. And here she has become the first Indian woman to win a gold and the fourth Indian to win the gold. So that's all about her. Now you would see this cute doll. What is this doll? So she is Somaiti, the mascot of Paralympics. And from here only my question is generated, that is the mascot of the recently held Tokyo Olympics, that you have to mention in the comment section below. And let's congratulate her. She is the one who has won the gold and became the first woman to win gold in Paralympics. So guys, on that note, let's begin today's video. But before that, if you haven't subscribed our channel till now, then do subscribe and hit the bell notification, and you can join our Telegram group as well, where you will get the PDF of this session for free after this session. Okay, so here we have the Global DeFi Adoption Index. What is India's rank in the Global DeFi Adoption Index? First of all, this DeFi means decentralized finance. Now, what is this decentralized finance? So this is basically a term that is used for blockchain enabled cryptocurrency platforms. So the adoption, the rate of adoption of such kind of platforms by individuals of a country is the basis of this index. Okay, now what is this all about? How is this ranking the countries and how many countries are being ranked? All of these we are going to discuss in the course of this video, but let's first know that which organization releases this index. So it is released by New York based Chainalysis. Chainalysis are the two words, and this is the portmanteau word Chainalysis. So it has released this Global DeFi Adoption Index. A week ago, it has also released the Global Cryptocurrency Adoption Index. Now in that index, India was ranked at the second position and Vietnam was at the first position. Pakistan was at the third position. Okay, so this was the Global Cryptocurrency Adoption Index released by Chainalysis, and this is the Global DeFi Adoption Index, that is talking about the investment made by the people in independent, autonomous, decentralized finance, that is cryptocurrency based platforms, the blockchain based financial platforms that have a specific purpose, specific financial service to offer. Okay, and in this index, India is ranked 6th. So now let's understand the premises of this index, because this is very important for you to understand what this index is telling you. Okay, the very first thing is DeFi stands for decentralized index, decentralized finance. It is basically a decentralized cryptocurrency platforms based on blockchain that can run autonomously without the support of a central company, group or person. So this platform, such kind of decentralized platform, finance platforms are not run by a central agency, be it the government, be it a private public company. So there is no central agency, there is no nodal agency that will run these decentralized platform. Decentralization is basically, it is quintessential of breaking down the centralization. So this is basically saying that only. So the platforms that are working autonomously, the blockchain based cryptocurrency platforms that are working autonomously. So this index is tracking the adoption of such kind of platforms in a country, because this is indicating, this is showing how much the country is progressing towards the fintech segment, because this is a part of fintech only, financial technology only. If you are depending on the decentralized finance financial platforms, because the conventional way of financing says us to invest in the traditional market instruments, in the traditional market instruments like banks. Okay, what we do if we have a lot of money, either we put it in the bank in the form of FD or we put it in stocks or debt of renowned companies. So these are some of the traditional ways that we know to invest our money into. But this is the decentralized finance, is the very nascent industry, is a very new form of investment that is coming up. So that is what being assessed by this Global DeFi Adoption Index. So decentralization finance platforms are built on blockchains, primarily on Ethereum network. So this is the most popular network at present. And they can fulfill some specific financial functions. For example, the crypto exchanges and lending platforms. So they have a particular specific function to perform. That is the exchanging crypto with the real money or the lending platforms or giving out the loans. So the index highlights the countries with highest grassroots adoption by individuals instead of values of funds channelized by DeFi. So one way of assessing the adoption of such kinds of platforms is to assess the number of people who have adopted such platforms. And the second way is the number of value, the amount of money that is channelized through DeFi. So this index is focusing on the number of individuals who have adopted decentralized financial technologies. So I hope, guys, this much is clear to you, because that was the basics. Now comes the facts. So a total number of 154 countries were assessed, and these are the three parameters on which the countries were assessed. Now, if you understand these parameters, it will become easier to for you to understand this index. So the first parameter is on-chain cryptocurrency value received by DeFi platforms weighted by per capita purchasing power parity per capita. Basically, this parameter assesses the DeFi activity in a country in relation to the purchasing power parity per capita of the country. The country with lower PPP would rank higher. So basically, how much activity has been done by the individuals of a country in relation to the purchasing power parity per capita of the country. So this PPP per capita denotes the income of an individual of a country in relation to the investment made by that person in the DeFi activity. So this is something that is assessed in this parameter. I hope that you're understanding. If my income is, if my PPP per capita is 1000, basically in India, if the PPP per capita is rupees 1000, okay, and out of that an average individual is investing or channelizing 200 rupees through DeFi activities or in DeFi platforms. If I'm investing 200 in DeFi platform, okay, so that is the relationship between the PPP per capita and the DeFi activity that is done by the individuals of a country. And the comparison, the ratio out of these two components will be assessed in this parameter. So this is the first parameter. And on the basis of that comparison, on the basis of the ratio, the ranking is given to the countries. Okay. Next comes total retail value received by DeFi platform. So here the investment made in the DeFi platform in comparison to the income of the individuals was assessed. Here the total retail value received by the DeFi platform is assessed. So this parameter assesses the value of cryptocurrency transactions that individuals have invested in DeFi platform. So here, what is the difference between these two parameters? This parameter is focusing on the income of the individual as well. And in comparison to that income, the ratio that the individual is investing in the DeFi platform. So on that basis, the ranking is decided in this parameter. However, this parameter is solely focusing on the amount the individuals are investing in the DeFi platform. So here it is driven by the value, the amount invested in the DeFi platform. And since the word retail is here, that means here we are not talking about the big investment or the investors. Here we are talking about the small retail investments. Okay. This ranks the countries on the basis of retail sized transactions, meaning under $10,000 compared to the wealth of average person. So Here we have been given the threshold as well. The next point is individual deposits to DeFi platform. So it ranks countries on the based on whose residents are carrying out the highest number of DeFi transactions. So if population wise, if you see, India has the second largest population in the world. So if the majority people of India are doing the investment in DeFi platform in comparison to Vietnam, obviously our ranking would be higher in this parameter. So that is all, that is the meaning of this parameter. However, parameter wise rankings are not given in this index. It is the overall ranking that is given in this index. And the next point here is that you don't need to memorize it. I hope that you have understood it, but even if there is a doubt that you cannot comprehend, the first thing is that you can ask me in the comment section below. And the second thing is that you don't have to cram your mind if you are not able to understand this thing, because in phase one, nobody is going to ask you that what does this parameter of this index mean. Okay, so here only the superficial level of understanding would also work for your phase one examination. But in case you are preparing for phase two, then obviously the decentralization financial platforms are very important for you. Okay, fintech mein they play a very important role. And if in your phase two you have a question, particularly I'm talking about the RBSEBI students, so if you face a question on cryptocurrency, blockchain, or increasing use of technology in the financial sector or IFSC for instance, then you can just cite this index as well in relation to India's performance in the adoption of these kinds of platforms. Okay, so in that case, these parameters and this index overall would become important for you. Now let's have a look at the rankings here. So US is at top with a score of 1. Overall ranking is 1, and these are the parameter wise ranking. Again, parameter wise ranking are not important. Then comes India at the 6th position. 0.59 is India's score, 6th is the ranking. On-chain DeFi value received, so here India's ranking is first. On-chain number of DeFi deposits, 120. And on-chain retail value received, again ranking 1. These rankings are not important when you are talking about this index particularly. Here overall ranking holds a major importance. And this is the overall outcome of this index. The data suggests that while the grassroots cryptocurrency adoption generally is highest in emerging markets, the DeFi adoption is strongest in high income countries. Okay, if you see the global cryptocurrency adoption index also released by the same organization, the organization, or we can say the index, has also pointed out towards the institutionalization of such platforms in high income countries like USA and China. So in the global cryptocurrency adoption index, Vietnam, India and Pakistan have been shown at the top three positions, whereas US and China have receded backwards. But does that mean that Vietnam, India and Pakistan are at the advantageous position in comparison to US and China when we are talking about cryptocurrency adoption? Not at all, guys. The reason here is that the number of people who are adopting these technologies is assessed in this index, whereas in US and China, it was the institutionalization that has reduced the number of people doing independent transactions on these platforms. They are doing such kind of transactions under an institution. Okay, so the entire process has been made formal and standardized in US and China or other high income countries. Okay, similarly, this is also saying that DeFi adoption is strongest in high income countries, and in cryptocurrency adoption index only, it was also highlighted that institutionalization of cryptocurrency is high in high income countries. Okay, what this point is saying, that DeFi adoption is highest in strongest in high income countries that already had substantial cryptocurrency usage, especially among traders and institutional investors. Now the tenure of assessment of this index was April 29 to June 2020. That was all about the global DeFi adoption index. again, I'm going to repeat myself, DeFi is nothing but the decentralized finance. Decentralized clearly indicates the financial platform that is not run by a central institution. Okay, so they are autonomous platforms that run on blockchain. They are the currency in which they deal is cryptocurrency. Of course, we are talking about a financial platform, therefore a currency would be involved. So the currency is cryptocurrency. The technology, the back end on which that platform is running is blockchain. Okay, so that is the basic premise of the global DeFi adoption index. Now, the next question that we have is, what is the name of the toolkit launched by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology to enable researchers and students to carry out research in quantum computing in a cost-effective manner? So here, the right answer is QSIM, Quantum Computer Simulator Toolkit. Guys, this is basically a toolkit, the online toolkit that will enable the researchers and students to carry out research by providing them information, okay, through this platform, through this toolkit. This toolkit has been developed under this project, Design and Development of Quantum Computer Toolkit and Capacity Building. And this project is run by IISc Bangalore, IIT Roorkee and CDAC of Ministry of Electronics and IT. Now, what do the students and researchers do under this platform? So this platform allows researchers and students to write and debug quantum code that is essential for developing quantum algorithms. Sorry. So this basically is something that you can totally leave out if you are not able to understand it, because this is completely technical and you are not supposed to give engineering examinations. We are preparing for banking exams. So itna detail mein to phase 2 mein bhi nahi puchhenge. So you can totally leave this out if you are not able to understand it. The toolkit is available in two modes. First is Param Shavak QSIM. This is basically a standalone system with quantum simulator in a box. Again, bahut technical hai, isme mat ghuso, kyunki otherwise it will take a lot of your time and it is not beneficial. Every time you are preparing for a competitive examination, you are supposed to prepare strategically. And according to me, you can just memorize it, because understanding it would take a lot of effort and time also. Next is Param QSIM Cloud, and this is available on cloud. Okay, cloud jo software hota, like your Microsoft Azure platform. Okay, available on cloud using HPC infrastructure of Param Siddhi AI. So basically here what you have to remember, the thing that you need to remember is this Param QSIM Cloud is available on the Param Siddhi AI. Okay. So that was all about this QSIM toolkit. The basic purpose of launching this toolkit is to allow the researchers and the students of India to research in the quantum computing field. That is the basic purpose. The QSIM, the toolkit, is available in two modes. The first mode is Param Shavak QSIM and the second one is Param QSIM Cloud. Moving on to the third question. Which of the following statement or statements is not correct about the Bharat series mark for vehicles? So this is the new mark revealed by Ministry of Road and Road Transport and Highway. So let's read the statement first. This BH mark on vehicle will bring uniformity in vehicle registration across India. This will help the citizens of India as they will not have to face the hassle of re-registration of their vehicles in other states. This is only applicable to new vehicles. It will be available on a voluntary basis to defense personnel, government employees at state, central state level, and private sector employees which have their offices in four or more states and union territories, and none of the above. So what do you think would be the right answer? Okay, so I'm leaving the guesses on you and telling you the right answer. The right answer is option E, none of the above. All of these statements are correct in relation to Bharat series, Bharat series mark for vehicles. So basically, the people who get transferred, ठीक है, public employees हो गए, the private employees who have offices in more than four states or union territories. So their employees get transferred very often. And in that scenario, they face trouble in re-registering their vehicles in the other state. Because at present, what the rule says that you can take your vehicle, private vehicle, in another state, but you can just operate that vehicle, you can just ply that vehicle on road for 12 months since the date of bringing that vehicle in that state, if you have not registered the vehicle within the state. But this is saying that if you are purchasing any new vehicle, you can just register that vehicle under this BH mark for vehicles only. Or if you are a government employee, a defense personnel, or a private sector employee that has offices in more than four states or union territories, then you can adopt for this BH series mark voluntarily, so that in future if you have to transfer in another state, then you won't find any kind of problem in just registering or in using your platform, because here the need for re-registering your platform is eliminated. So you can just use your vehicle in any other state if you have this BH mark for vehicle. Let me tell you that this is not for free. You will be charged. So there is a motor vehicle, there is a tax in the Motor Vehicles Act that will be charged from you if you go for registering your vehicle under this Bharat series mark. However, this would be cheaper, because if you talk about the defense personnel, they have transfers across India, and if they go on registering their personal vehicles in every state, then they would have to pay a lot of tax. Or we can say registration fees, in other words, for registering the vehicle in the state. So this is basically a one-time payment that they would have to make in order to obtain this Bharat series mark for their vehicles. So that was all about this mark that has been recently launched by the Ministry of Road Transport and Highway. Next comes, who heads the committee formed by central government to streamline the revenue litigation pending before the Supreme Court? So basically, it was observed by the Supreme Court that the lawsuits related to indirect and direct taxes were taking a lot of time in filing appeals. So in order to reduce the time period, a committee has been formed. So that committee is going to be headed by Ashish Shridhonkar. So he is basically at present the head of e-courts project at National Informatics Information Center. So he is heading this project. Now, Ashish Shridhonkar is going to head this committee, which will work on developing an electronic management system and electronic platform for filing the appeals in a cost-effective manner and time-bound manner. So that is the basic purpose of this committee, and the committee is bound to give its recommendations or develop the platform within 3 months from its constitution. So from 3 months from now, the committee will have to give the platform to the government. Okay, so this committee has been formed after Supreme Court reprimanded the government for not doing anything in this regard. And because of this, a lot of revenue loss was happening, because tax dispute ki wajah se, if it is not going to be handled or resolved in a time-bound manner, there would be a loss of revenue for the government as well. Okay. Now, the other thing related to this committee that you need to know is that this committee is going to be monitored by the Secretary of Department of Revenue under Ministry of Finance. And who is that person at present? Tarun Bajaj. Okay. So he is going to monitor this committee and provide all the necessary support that this committee would need in order to develop that platform. How much amount can be kept in small PPIs, prepaid payment instruments, in a month as per new guidelines of RBI? So recently, Master Circular on prepaid payment instruments has been released by RBI, in which RBI has given certain recommendations, or not at all recommendations. These are the guidelines that have to be followed by the PPI providers. Okay. So what are these guidelines? We will be looking at those, but let's first know the answer of this question. So it is rupees 10,000 per month. Now, what is this all about? You will understand it now. So basically, in the master circular, what RBI has done is RBI has divided the PPI into two categories. One is small PPIs and the other one is full KYC PPI. So the small PPIs are those PPIs which are allowed for purchase of goods and services only. So the people who have subscribed to the small PPIs can only do the goods and service purchase through those PPIs. PPI kya hota hai? For example, your Paytm wallet is a PPI, prepaid payment instrument. Your debit card is a PPI. Okay. So here your amount is, you already pay the amount in that card and then you go for purchasing the goods or services by using that card. So this is basically a digital way to eliminate cash. Okay. Fund transfer and cash withdrawal is not allowed from these PPIs because they are small PPIs. Their pocket size is small. So how much is the pocket size? It is 10,000 per month. So you can keep only 10,000 per month if you are obtaining a small PPI. And they should not exceed 1.2 lakh in a year. Full KYC PPIs are those PPIs that will obtain a lot of information from you because they are fully compliant. Fully KYC compliant PPI. So they would also ask about your PAN number or other information that are relevant for them. Okay. And they will allow you fund transfer and cash withdrawals as well. Okay. The amount in these PPIs shall not exceed 2 lakh at any point of time. So you cannot keep more than 2 lakh in these PPIs. So this is the highest amount that you can keep. So if you remember that RBI has allowed RTGS and NEFT on the payment service providers as well. So in that scenario, this becomes very important. Fully KYC PPI. So fund transfer is nothing but the NEFT or RTGS that you do from bank. If you transfer your fund from one bank to another bank by using these services, now you can use this service as well, the PPI service, in order to transfer your fund. But which kind of PPI can you use? You can use only fully KYC compliant PPI. Earlier, closed system, semi-closed system and open system PPIs were the three categories in which RBI had divided the prepaid payment instruments. Now let's look at the interoperability. So what does RBI say for interoperability? So RBI says that the PPI issuers should have a board approved policy for that. This is not important. Interoperability via UPI is mandated for wallet PPIs, Paytm wallet, and you have phone pay wallet. So these are the wallets that you have. So if you are operating a wallet, basically this is not for the consumer side. This is the payment service providers part that they have to fulfill. So Paytm, the company Paytm 197 Communication, will have to fulfill this obligation to provide interoperability. It needs to provide UPI in its wallet in order to make it interoperable. Where PPIs are issued in the form of cards, physical or virtual. If you are using Paytm bank, then you would also have come across the Paytm debit card and credit card. So that is the virtual form of credit or debit card that you get. Okay, physical, so we all know. So the cards should be affiliated to the authorized card network. So Paytm Pay, you would get the RuPay card. Okay. PPI for mass transit systems are exempted from interoperability. Gift PPI issuers, both banks and non-banks, have the option to offer the interoperability. QR codes in all modes shall be interoperable by March 31st, 2022. So that is the, these are the directions on interoperability that RBI has given. And this is the grievance redressal mechanism that RBI has put in place for the PPI consumers. So there should be a formal publicly disclosed consumer grievance redressal framework. Now, what is important here is this point, that there should be a nodal officer that would handle the complaints or grievances of the consumers. Also, the PPIs issued by the banks and non-banks. Non-banks are NBFCs, non-banking financial companies. So if these companies are issuing the PPIs, then the consumers need to have a recourse. They should have the access to banking ombudsman scheme and ombudsman scheme for digital transactions, respectively for grievance redressal. So that's all, guys. That is all for this circular directions or circular about the PPIs and for today's video as well. Thank you so much for watching the video.